Hi, I'm Bob Marley, and you're watching Countdown right across Australia. We describe our music as a road to consciousness. But we call it music still, you know, revolutionary music.
Revolutionary in what respect?
Revolutionary of the mind, you know, bring the reality of what has been hidden from the wise and the prudent to the babe and the suckling. Yeah, a lot of children.
Yeah, with the children and everyone. Everyone was smiling. And
no need for the children to be sad, you know.
Dancing.
They're innocent.
Yeah.
Right? All children innocent. So them should be happy. It can be copied, you know, but it's not copied with it. It's the feel, you know. It carry a feel where if you ask plenty musician, them know it, but them can't do it. So people still searching for this truth here, which this reggae music, you know, bring Christ to them, and the only purpose it serves is to tell the people about Rastafari. Well, I've been a Rasta from ever since, you know, but it's not how long I've been a Rasta, it's how long it takes you to grow up, because what is what is from beginning to the end. You can never change, because if you even adapt things later out, you don't filter right out. So we're just Rasta from creation, you know. For me, it's a common sense, man. That means when me explain things, me explain it in a very simple way. That means if I explain it to a baby, the baby will understand too, you know? So we were saying, oh, like the Bible. The Bible says, God same shall return as the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the conquering line of a tribe of Judah. And him shall come in a new name. And this new name shall be dreadful among the heathen.
How important are the dreadlocks?
This?
Is that
this
part
is my
of being
identity, man. Yeah, this is my identity. I don't come to bow, you know. I come to conquer. I don't come to bow, I come to conquer. My home is always where I am. My home is in my head. My home is what I think about. Or I try to set my mind in the thinking that I think. That is my home. My home is not a material home out somewhere out there. You know, my home in my head.
Have you made a lot of money out of your music?
Money? I mean, what is how much is a lot of money to you?
Yeah, that's a good question. Have you made, say, millions of dollars?
No.
Are you a rich man?
When you mean rich, what do you mean?
You have a lot of possessions, a lot of money in the bank.
Position make you rich? I don't have that type of richness. My richness is life, forever.
In your songs, you often refer to the Bible, but many of the young people who are coming to your concert don't believe in the Bible anymore.
Because the way they've been taught about the Bible, that is not the way of the Bible. You know what I mean? because if I was living in that world where the everyday interpretation of the Bible go on, then I would have ate the Bible too. But now that we have found the right way of the Bible, then the Bible is to be loved, because the Bible is a record of man creation. It's the only book tell you, it's the only book can make, can show you where mankind begin without any prejudice or anything like that, any boastiness, pride or anything. It just have how it go, and that's it. Well, all the Christian people, not even a Christian, all the people who go to churches interpret the Bible and the preachers them. That is not the right way. Because the greatest thing is that life. See? It's life. Life I deal with. If the preacher read the Bible and tell you that you have to die to go to heaven, then it's not reading the Bible. Because the Bible tell you you have to live in a heaven. You don't die and go to heaven. You have to live in heaven. You know, a lot of places on earth could be. But Africa is our heaven, because that's where we come from. You know, maybe if it's a Swiss, maybe if you're from Switzerland and the people know God, then maybe you could live in peace, unity, harmony, you know. But, you know, people are stubborn on this earth because of material vanity. You know, while living, we know that when you're sick, you go to the doctor. So nobody wants to die. So if you don't want to die, then there's something happening there. So the best man to find out from if he can live is God. Now, to find out from God, you have to find God. Now, when we search in reality, we find Haile Selassie, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Conqueror, Lion of Judah. That is our tradition.
How big is the influence of the Rasta communities in Jamaican culture and politics today? And perhaps you can give some examples.
Well, you know, as Rasta, we're dealing with not politics, but our own tradition from creation, from the root of mankind. So we as Rasta now, we return to our roots, which is God, you know. So, and as you know, politics divide and rule. Politics don't show people God. Politics tell you that somebody can do something for you, you know. What we know is God will do everything. So the best man to deal with is God. When you deal with God, you don't deal with politics, because politics divide and rule.
Do you have to smoke to be a Rasta?
No, man. But in this time, I mean, like, for instance, you're reaching a sense where you're strong enough, can take a little smoke. So when all them cars pass, although you live in the city, you don't hear it, because you're thinking differently if you just live so. Then, you know what I mean, the whole world confuse you and you're worried and you don't have no time to think. And herb is a thing that give you a little time for yourself so you can live, if you use it. The more you accept herb is the more you accept Rastafari. You dig what I say? We who accept herb is important, but herb is more important to the people who don't accept it yet, because that is a reality. I mean, it's not Sevelin is something that you crave, but you check it in your sense and say, herb is a plant. I mean, herbs are good for everything. Why these people want to do so much good?
Lucky Dube is a Rastafarian, depending, of course, on, you know, how you look at it. Because some people say a Rastafarian is one who plays reggae, one who has dreadlocks, and one who smokes ganja. but according to my knowledge, according to my belief, that's not what Rastafarianism is, you know. Because there's a lot of people out there who smoke ganja, but who are not Rastafarians. My grandfather used to smoke ganja, a lot. I mean, a lot of ganja was growing everywhere. They would smoke it before before the cigarettes and the boxers and things came. And anyway, cigarette was only for white people. You wouldn't smoke cigarette as a black person. At one time, I remember you had to get a white person to buy you cigarettes and all the, you know, but that. So they were smoking ganja, which was growing, you know, wild thing, and they would just smoke that. But they didn't know anything about Rastafarianism and all of that. And so one who smoke ganja does not make you Rasta. Dreadlocks do not make you Rasta, because dreadlocks don't have anything to do with reggae and Rastafarianism, as far as I'm concerned, because dreadlocks were there in Africa before reggae music, before everything, before guitars, and before recording studios. Black people in Africa were dreadlocks because they did not have combs. That is, before the white men came with a comb, people were dreadlocks. So dreadlocks and Rasta got tied up together, I mean, during the times of Bob, now. But people in Africa were always dreadlocks. And Rasta, being a Rasta to me is being conscious about things around you, be it politically or socially.
Before we start this song, I want to see everybody like this, please. One more time, I think for the last time today. It's now or never. Some people are actually leading you, or rather leading us, into killing each other. Now it's time that we say no to that. You know who you are. Nobody's gonna tell you what to do, because there's only one man that can give or take life, Jah the Creator. No one is supposed to take life but Jah Rastafari. So right now we're singing this song to peace in South Africa. Not only amongst blacks, but to say to everybody, we say black and white, we want to be together as one. Jah Rastafari. We cry for peace. Cry for love in this neighborhood. No water can put out this fire, only the Lord sees the peace in this neighborhood. We cry for peace. Follow in this neighborhood. No water can put out this fire. Only the Lord and Savior comes in this neighborhood. If you follow politicians, never come far. You follow politicians, you will never come far. You follow politicians, you will never come far. Jah Rastafari, he's the Savior. If you follow politicians, you'll never come far. You follow politicians, you will never come far.
follow politicians, you'll never come far. John Rastafari, he's the savior.
Yeah, reggae came after, I think I had recorded about 6 Zulu albums, and I always heard reggae on the radio, right, from like Peter Tosh and them, but not so much on the radio, because reggae at that time was not wanted by the South African government and of course by the people in South Africa, because if you were found like with a Bob Marley or a Peter Tosh tape, they would kick the shit out of you and the whole thing, break the tape or arrest you or whatever, you know. So we would only hear a little bit of it, like Jimmy Cliff and them. Jimmy Cliff, who was not as militant as Bob and Peter, so we would hear those. And I was also, I got very interested in reggae, but I could not do it at that time because the record company was also not interested in reggae acts and things like that. Producers and them were not interested in reggae. And so it was around about 1984 that I decided to record reggae, you know. When doing my live shows with the Mbaqanga music, I would throw in a little bit of my reggae stuff. And the people would like that. People would really like that. And eventually we decided, yeah, this is great. We must record this because people like it. And we recorded the first reggae album in 1984.
Amaqweqwe kalakhe afumene igolide maqweqwe lawo ebacula ngesizulu nangesingesi nangaphandle kwamathandabuzo irigay yakhe iyakuqaqamba okwegolide phesheya iphele kwa ligcunswana lethamsanqa.
One time I got my family, when everybody was together, you know, everybody's back from work and school and all of that, in the living room, I would get my guitar and make everybody pay. They would pay maybe 3 cents or 2 cents, and then I would be on the table. That's a concert, and that would be a stadium to me. And then they would pay me that, and I would play that. And I, in my mind, yes, there was this thing that was saying, one day all of this will be real.
Somebody told me about it. When I was still a little boy.
It was basically the message, really, in the music that got me. Because all of the things that Peter Tosh and Bob sang about are things that I personally have experienced in life. Poverty, hunger, this and that, oppression and all of that. All of that, those are things that I have personally experienced.
You were not there to be found.
The first time I got a guitar or a melodica was when I was doing, I think, standard 7 in Standerton. I stole my class teacher's guitar. He was also a very musical person. So in the staff room, he had a guitar, one of these acoustic guitars and things like that. So I stole his guitar and I took it to the school library because I was a library assistant there. And so no one had the key to the library, but I had the key to the library. So I stole this guitar from his, from the staff room, and I hid it in my, in the library. And so when everybody's gone, I would try and play it and play that guitar. And after having learned a little bit of that guitar, I went and I stole his melodica because it was like a choir master thing. And so I stole his melodica and I took it, I put it in my the library, and I started learning, just touching keys there and all of that. And that was the first time I got near like a real instrument. But all the time I was just playing from tin homemade things.
Yeah, ma. As a little boy.
It's places that we don't usually do when doing tours and shows and things like that. But it's people out there, there's people out there who like the music, who support the music and everything, but they just can't get to see you. And so with the now Ace coming in, we go out there to do the Ace promos. At the same time, the people out there get to see this Lucky Dube person that they love so much. And, you know, who doesn't go there for shows and things like that?
I think Lucky Dube is the best musician in the world.
The important thing here is to get the message across to people. And I find that people understand English, you know, more than any language. Because you go to Japan, they speak English, you know, a little bit, but, you know, you can communicate with them in English. And you go to France, they speak English, and everywhere it's English. So to get the message across to people, I decided to do it in English because everybody understands it.
Hey, Rastaman, hey, Rakia,
but today, I am a
music's gonna end up being, but okay, Japanese technology and all of that is good because they make things easier. Like my band is on the road all the time. What I'm saying is it's good that they are making things smaller and easier to carry around, but the programmings and things like that, I mean, you find that there's one guy on stage, he just plays one keyboard, and there's like the drums and things, everything coming in, there's just one guy on stage. I mean, I think it's not right for the people, because people pay money to go see a band on stage. And I mean, I would also like to see like live and get some live things, you know. We don't have to like misuse this technology thing, but it's good that we grow musically. We get new stuff and all of that. And I remember like in the studios they used to have like these huge echo machines, you know, like the ones they had downstairs, like this huge. And those things you could not carry, you could not take those on tour. But now with the smaller things, you take those on tour, and people in this concert place get the same quality that they hear on the record. And it's great, but not to like get the machines to do some work for us.
I'm reggae. I mean, there's a song I wrote some years ago saying, you know, the bed that I sleep on is a reggae bed, and everything I do is reggae. So, I mean, I'll always be reggae, even though, you know, I might do some other projects on the side. I mean, you know, just on the side, but not as my own project. But we grow musically, you know, and so I'll always be doing reggae. It's in me, you know. I'll always be doing reggae.
Lucky Dube for Prisoner.
And I'd like to say thank you very much, Jagite and Protect, the man in a debubble and Secha, because them a one time I come at them funeral.
Maybe God planned it that way. God wanted it to be like that. And the people in South Africa, to start with, because the people in South Africa are the ones that started supporting my music and made it, you know, like built it. And they allowed me to be what I wanted to be. Because sometimes you would want to be something, and the people maybe might not allow you to be what you want to be. You know, maybe, yeah, it's just that, God and the people. Because I'm just there doing what I do, but how it happens, I don't know, because I don't write hit songs. I don't sit down and say, now I'm going to write like a hit song or something. But I just write songs as they come, and people make them hit songs. And that's all. I mean, God planned it that way, and the people.
Thank you.
Yes, man.
The song Slave was released around about 1987, and in the video we just wanted to show people what liquor does to people, because I have been a victim of that. We know that a lot of families have broken up because of liquor, and it was a very big problem, especially in the black community.
Have we returned me many times?
That was a song that talked about the people, the freedom fighters, people that were in jails, people that have died, people that were still fighting for freedom. It was basically a song about the freedom fighters.
Freedom fighter, standing on a mountain in a foreign country, trying to send a message to his people back in the ghetto. He had a home one time, love of a girl, but he left all that behind. Oh yeah, I can hear it clearly as he whispers.
I did this video, Prisoner, I nearly got shot by the police. We were doing the video in Soweto somewhere, and it was during the time when Soweto was a bit scary. There were a lot of guns and things going on there. And so, as you will see in the video, I've got a gun with me. And I had this gun, and there was this police van that was passing by, and they didn't know that there's a video being shot, and they thought I'm some criminal with a gun at a shopping center or something, and they came for me, and the director had to come and go, no, it's a video camera, you know, things like that, and they nearly shot me, you know, but I really enjoyed doing that video. Because there was this part where I was dragged by horses and things like that, and I enjoyed doing that because I love making movies.
Somebody told me about it. Education.
hospital, well, in prison, prison. They won't build no schools anymore. Oh, they build, well, in prison, prison. They won't build no schools anymore. Oh, they build, well, in prison, prison. Cause today, yeah, I am.
Yeah.